as the country prepares for general elections 2019, this is the first time that so much attention is being given in the party manifestos to the subject of environment. Hello and welcome to this week's episode of Earth Talks. This is the show where we discuss everything green. We're looking for ideas that work. We're looking for solutions to some very complex problems. And with me today, we have Santosh Harish. He's a fellow at the Center for Policy Research. I have with me Brikesh Singh. He's leading the Clean Air Collective. This is a conglomerate of nearly 60 NGOs that are fighting for clean air around the country. And thank you so much for joining us today. This is a day after we now have both the manifestos with us, whether it's the Congress or it's the BJP. So we're going to brainstorm today on how these manifestos have approached the issue of environment, particularly air pollution, because we're living really in a time of crisis. So if I can start with you, Santosh, and if you can tell us, what do you make of both the manifestos? What excites you? What's missing?
Thanks, Bahar, and thanks for having me on this. I think the first thing to note is I'm very glad that air pollution is showing up at all. It's come up in both of the major parties. I hope that the Aam Aadmi Party will also have it, since it's sort of under the scanner a little bit in Delhi. So, firstly, glad it's there. And I mean, we need to also, I think, remember that this has happened, especially when it comes to air pollution, at a fairly rapid pace. I think the engagement of the public and the media has really taken off in the last few years. So for the parties to be responsive to that, it's wonderful. So looking at the two manifestos, the BJP manifesto struck me as, you know, essentially trying to strike this continuity that, look, we've done these things, and if elected back, we'll continue to do things of this kind. So I think across the board, the renewable energy targets, the way they talk about air pollution, there is this sense of, here's what we've been doing and we'll continue doing that. With air pollution, they have basically, I think, changed a couple of things. One, they have claimed that they have a target of 35% reduction in concentrations in the next 5 years, and that the National Clean Air Program that they released in January this year will be converted into a mission. In contrast, and just, I think, staying on the air pollution in the air pollution theme, the Congress manifesto does a couple of very interesting things. One, it declares air pollution as a national public health emergency. I think that's very strong language for a political party to use. The National Clean Air Program, for example, does nothing of the sort. so I think it's important that the people are saying that in unequivocal terms, because something that I think officially the government position has been doing time and time again is taking the sense of health impacts denial, saying that no, we know that it is harmful, but we don't know precisely how harmful it is.
Or also that Indian lungs are special and they can deal with
very high Indian levels of studies. And we don't believe these international reports and so on. The problem with that is that you cannot claim to be acting on something with a sense of urgency and simultaneously claiming that it's not that big a problem. There's just a problem of an ambiguous level, right? So getting it out there is important. And I think the other very interesting thing about the Congress manifesto was that it talks about, if I get this right, an independent, transparent, and empowered Environment Protection Authority. Essentially, I think recognizing that there is a structural problem in the way we've been dealing with air pollution, and that the regulatory institutions should be significantly more effective, should have more teeth. I think those were two promising things about it.
Okay, excellent. Brikesh, you represent civil society. You're also someone who interacts with NGOs, with citizens on a daily basis. There is a need. Clearly, both the manifestos have recognized that air pollution is a problem. We're finding mention, in the manifestos. But are they addressing the gravity of the situation?
I was personally surprised to see the language that the Congress manifesto used of actually not mincing any words and calling it a health emergency.
Yes.
Especially in the last couple of years, where we've seen our environment minister sending out a tweet saying, show me a death certificate mm-hmm. which shows the cause as, so from there, we have moved to a place where we do have a national clean air plan, which talks about setting targets and, yes. and cleaning it up in 102 cities, and now in both the manifestos. So that was one. Second was Congress manifesto has also mentioned that they're going to set sectoral emission targets, mm-hmm. which I think is missing in NCAP. NCAP now has a list, a laundry list of 93 items that needs to be yes. done. So that's
so
welcome.
When you're talking about NCAP, that's the National Cleaner Clean Program, which yeah. was introduced by the NDA.
That's right.
Yeah.
On BJP, it's like Santosh said, that it's basically, it has a tone of we've working on it. You know, we started work on it a couple of years ago. We're going to continue working on mm-hmm. it. The only thing that I have very high hopes, I mean, being an mm-hmm. optimist, is the mention that they're going to turn National Clean Air Program into a mission. Mm. Now, with a big if. Mm. If what they mean by mission is the Swachh Bharat mission.
And setting targets and
exactly.
everybody getting involved, then it's great.
Then it's yeah. it's a big booster shot, because I think we will have the Prime Minister himself championing the clean air mission. Mm. But is it going to be that? I don't know. I'm just trying to compare it to Swachh Bharat mission.
Okay. So you're happy with the words that the Congress has used. You feel that the BJP is lacking somewhere on the targets. But I would argue that isn't it easy for the Congress to give this like wish list, because they're not in power, right? Whereas the BJP has been in power. So it's easier for them, you know, for the Congress to say, we'll do this, because right now, you know, they're not in power, so you can't judge them against something, right? So would you not say that is a problem, because the problem really is of implementation?
No, that's right. I mean, we do have a very bad track record of what's written in the manifesto and what gets implemented. But talking from a civil society point of view, where lots of citizens groups and organizations have put in a lot of effort in the last 3 years with doing advocacy and lobbying and trying to meet ministers to make sure that this gets included in the manifesto. Mm. Mm. So from there, I think it's a welcome step,
yes.
and it actually encourages the civil society that, okay, finally we've got it in the manifesto. If we compare it to last year, none of this was there.
Mm.
So okay. the air is not going to get clean in the next decade, I would say, but at least it gives some sort of energy for the civil society to hold them accountable for what's written in their document.
Okay.
And I mean, sorry if I
please.
Could jump in.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess manifestos are also about declaring your intent to act, right? I mean, in the sense that you don't really expect to see a very well substantiated, you know, point by point thing that, look, here is what we're going to do. So in that sense, in the declaring intent thing, I like that the Congress is willing to say this.
Mm.
Just to go back a little bit about the National Clean Air Program, several of us have talked about how it's a fairly flawed document.
Mm.
The program in and of itself is not something that is drastically new. In fact, it is highly status quoist, right? It basically is a compilation of the various things that the government has been doing anyway.
Mm.
And the only new things that it introduced was that you had these new targets for concentration
yes.
reductions. And you had the action shifting beyond Delhi alone to these 102 cities.
Yeah. The non-attainment cities
right.
are not addressed. The fact that a lot of the pollution happens in, you know, in the rural areas, for instance.
Correct.
We keep saying cities.
Right.
And the rural areas are never addressed. It's almost like the people in rural areas don't have lungs, or, you know, they have superpowers.
I mean, cities is itself like a very poor framing of the
yes.
problem. For the reasons you just mentioned, that in the Indo-Gangetic Plain in North India, if you look at the satellite data, you don't really see much of a difference between the urban and rural areas in terms of the air quality levels.
Mm.
So arguably, the lens with which we want to be looking at it is as a regional problem.
Mm.
So this city by city approach sort of misses the point.
Mm.
Where the conversion of this into a mission is promising is that something the NCAP was lacking was any sense of accountability.
Mm.
That if these targets were to be missed, what would happen? Mm. Would there be financial consequences? Would there be legal consequences?
Yeah.
So hopefully with
missing.
A mission,
yeah.
some
right.
of these things get institutionalized better.
Okay.
And get more fleshed out. Okay. So yeah, fingers crossed.
So that's something positive. Yeah. Let's turn to the part on energy. What do you think that the BJP manifesto addresses the issue of renewables? And so let's get reactions from you and then Brikesh.
With the BJP manifesto, they basically have already, they have an ambitious RE expansion program. Which has been doing quite well. I think that's
been one of the successes. That's a thumbs up.
I mean, that's been one of the successes of this government, I think.
Okay.
That they were able to have this ambitious target and, seemingly we're doing progress towards that target. It seems like a continuation of that. Actually, the Congress manifesto, in contrast, when it comes to the RE targets, was sort of wishy-washy. We are going to encourage clean energy and in thermal power plants and move towards greener.
It was words. And do you think the BJP, for instance, didn't capitalize on some of its own programs? Like you were mentioning the Ujjwala program. So it could have drawn on that and mentioned that in the manifesto.
I think it should, absolutely. The Ujjwala program, which basically provides LPG access to the poorest households, something that this government launched a couple of years back, targets multiple things. One, it is providing access to a modern cooking fuel to households which are otherwise using firewood and dung cakes and so forth. So there is access to energy story there. But then household use of biomass is also the single biggest contributor to the average national exposure to particulate matter. The single biggest, right? On average. So this is, to be clear, separate to the effects felt by the households burning these these fuels themselves. So not only do you have those indoor impacts, you also have these larger. So it's a big program. It's an important program. The BJP manifesto is curiously silent on how they want to take this forward, which I think is a missed opportunity.
Brikesh, as far as energy is concerned, do you think both the manifestos address clean energy, renewables?
It does, adequately? And I agree with Santosh on the missed opportunity both for Congress and BJP. On BJP, they do put the spotlight on the renewable energy program, which is on target to achieve 175 gigawatts. However, there is no mention of simultaneously also reducing our dependence on fossil fuels or traditional sources of energy. They in fact go ahead and say that they will provide 24/7 electricity to everyone with a good energy mix. So I think the BJP could have capitalized on the amazing work that they are doing on solar and said that on the side we will also reduce our dependence on fossil fuels. In the Congress manifesto, they've shied away from giving any numbers or targets. However, the words that they've written in the manifesto, it talks about encouraging investment off-grid renewable power, which it looks like decentralized. So actually giving energy independence to every household and village, which is good. I think, again, it's a missed opportunity for Congress as well. They should have gone a step ahead and said that they will invest heavily and set a target of either exceeding what the NDA is mentioning, and then again mention something about thermal power plants. They're just one line saying that we will move towards cleaner energy while reducing fossil fuels, but nothing more.
Okay, let's come to an issue which I have a lot of interest in, which is forests and biodiversity. It's been almost that's where you want to give the thumbs down on the subject of forests. For instance, the BJP manifesto, for some odd reason, says that because we have expedited forest and environment clearance, we have added 9,000 square kilometers is what they're saying. 90,000 hectares is what it, I think, comes to, round about that much. So is there some kind of a dichotomy here? I mean, how can forest and environment clearances, which are essentially about chopping down forests for development projects, lead to more forests being created? Is there something wrong here, Brikesh?
I don't know. I laughed out loud when I read that. I don't know what they meant by it. Both on Congress as well as in the Congress as well as the BJP manifesto, there's not much as far as forests are concerned. We've seen that at least the BJP has been you know, doing a frontal assault as far as clearance is concerned, and they don't even shy away from mentioning it. Yeah. I don't know if that's a Freudian slip or what's there. Right. And neither do I see anything from Congress. They yeah. just, it says yes. redefine the role of forest departments. Yeah. That's
yes.
it.
Yes. Unfortunately, I don't know very much about forestry, but I was wondering if whatever they've said about forest rights and the role of local communities is...
They have. So Congress mentions about Forest Rights Act. It says that people will not be displaced. Mm. So everybody's made the right noise. Mm. But I find it interesting that you mentioned that forests and biodiversity have not been addressed adequately. And again, that seems to be a symptom, I think, of you don't see this as a vote bank. You know, it's not seen as something which would be important to voters. Mm. But interestingly, air pollution is there because I think thanks to the campaigns done by civil society, by the media, by researchers, it's now being recognized as a mainstream problem. Mm. So maybe that's the one positive takeaway from both these manifestos.
Could be. I mean, in the last 3 years, a lot of noise was made, not just in Delhi, but other urban areas as well, as far as air pollution is concerned. When it comes to cutting down forests for energy, it's out of sight, out of mind. Mm-hmm. So people in the city will not make noise about forest destruction. But they will make noise about polluted air, and both these fall under the larger umbrella of climate change. That could be the reason.
Okay, Santosh, final comments. What do you think was missing in the manifestos? Anything which you think should have been included, was not included? Some final comments.
Well, I mean, at least as manifestos go, I think it's about making the right noises at some level. I had a quick sort of note on why it should matter that air pollution becomes a political issue, right? We have historically relied on the judiciary to step in because the executive has been unwilling to do anything substantive about air pollution. But there are various issues where it's only possible for us to be able to do anything substantial if the elected government is able to step in terms of empowering the agencies, ensuring that they are well funded, sufficiently transparent, and you know, allowed to discharge their responsibilities without having to, you know, make a trade-off between ease of doing business and ensuring that that polluting firms are kept under check, making difficult choices, right, and resolving contested claims from various affected stakeholders. So it's important that politics starts engaging.
Yeah.
There's a political action on air pollution. So yeah, I'm glad.
Okay.
Cautiously optimistic.
Okay, cautiously optimistic. Yeah. Brikesh, anything which you would have wanted should have been included in the manifesto, but it's not there, both the manifestos?
Though I'm happy that it's there in both the manifestos, and I wasn't expecting it to, especially in the Congress manifesto, to be, you know, to be written the way it is. But I think we still have a long way to go. Yeah, people, the civil society will have to now. I mean, it's written in the document, but none of the election speeches anywhere in those 102 non-attainment cities, no one's making a noise about it. So I want to see, maybe not this election, but maybe 2024. I want to see health swaying an election.
Right.
Onion prices sway an election in a country, and temples and all sorts of things. But health has never swayed an election in India. So,
So health, air pollution, these are the real issues as the country goes to elections. The manifestos have included some environmental issues like air pollution. There's also a thumbs up to the inclusion of issues such as energy. Let's hope now that the parties now follow up on the commitments made in their manifestos. Thank you for watching these talks.
Thank you.